Hello everyone, my name is Abel Sinkovics. I came here from the Metaparse University, Hungary, and I'm doing a PhD there. And this PhD involves template metaprogramming and functional programming. And as part of my PhD, I've done a few template metaprogramming libraries. Well, it belongs to that, so it is part of that. And I'm going to present one of the libraries, well, sort of one of the libraries, and mentioning a few other things from other libraries. So one of the libraries is Metaparse. And this is, I've collected all the libraries I've created into a metaprogramming library collection called MPLibs. And it has four components. Metaparse, this is the one I'm going to talk about today, so it is about parsing at compile time. There's another one called MetaMonad, which is a monad, Haskell monad implementation for template metaprogramming. This is the fuel compile time version. And there is MetaTest, which is a utility for testing, unit testing template metaprograms. And there is a save printf implementation, which is different than Boost format in a way that it has zero overhead on top of non-save printf. So it does type checking at compile time, and after that it just calls the unsafe printf at runtime. And it is based on metaparse. So I parse the format string using metaparse, or a parser is built using metaparse, and then I type check the arguments.
Means you can't use it for unloaded strings.
No. But in my experience, 90% of the promise strings come at compile time. So who are the people who are working on these libraries? There is Zoltan Porkolab sitting over there. And there is Andre Shayo, who is not here today. And there's me, of course. Okay, what I'm going to talk about today? Well, I'm going to talk about parsing at compile time in general. What is this? What I mean by parsing at compile time? And where it can be used, or at least I'm going to show you a few examples where it can be used. Yeah?
Turn the lights off?
Is that this one?
Is that enough? Yeah, well, we can do that. And that? And that? Is that good enough?
Yep.
Are there any other lights we can turn off?
There's a table and a phone.
The sun.
If you can turn that off, you can extort a lot of money from the government. Or
something. $1 million.
So, the agenda for this talk, I'm going to talk about why compile time parsing is good. I'm going to present metaparse, but I'm going to present it quickly, and I'll just show you the key point of this. After that, I'll show you a fairly non-trivial example. So I'm going to build a Haskell interpreter running at compile time based on metaparse. And at the end of the talk, I'm going to show you advanced parse creation technique, which is based on monads. So here is a function. Here is a template meta function. I call it f. To avoid you figuring out what it's doing by its name. So I'd like to ask you to raise your hand if you know what this function is doing.
Please tell.
It is not a difficult function, actually. I can see
no answers.
You are adding minus 1 to minus 2.
Okay, no hands so far, so I'm giving you a little
hand.
How about this? This is Haskell. The same thing in Haskell. Raise your hands now if you know what it's doing. I can see a few hands. Okay, someone who'd like to...
Well, in our fairness, you didn't highlight the parts of the template code that...
Yes, I didn't do that, but Bartosz did yesterday. It's true. But what I did was putting the same thing in Haskell again, and after putting it into Haskell, I saw almost everyone raising his hand. So someone... Yeah, almost good. Yeah, exactly. Why is it broken?
Because the condition was the wrong one. round. It was m less than 2, then do the recursive.
Exactly. So I put that here. We can either find this bug this way, or we can either find this bug this way. And of course, this one's much easier than the other one. And the nice thing is, what I'm going to show you is how to make this thing real. I mean, how you can write your template metaprogram this way, embed into your C++ code that way, and make the C++ compiler deal with it. I mean, any standard compiler, C++ compiler, will turn it into a meta function and you can use it afterwards. So that's the most complicated.
That's totally awesome.
I don't want to know how long it takes to compile.
You will see it. We've done measurements as well. But this is only one of the examples for compile-time parsing. Here is another one, the expressive library for regular expressions. If we do that, we can write a regular expression in the normal way, what most people are used to. But that is not going to check, or not going to get checked at compile time. So if I make a mistake, a typo, or whatever there, that will be a runtime error. Or I can use the other option expressive provides and build the regular expression this way. And in this case, it will be type checked. But this syntax is not as readable as that one, even though it's pretty tricky and smart. For someone who's familiar with regular expressions, but is not familiar with this syntax, will not be able to read it until he learns this syntax. So it would be nice if we could write it that way, and from this, make the compiler automatically generate that one. And this is also possible with metaparse and these techniques. Another example, still a similar one, the Spirit library, with which we can create parsers. And here is a parser definition, but this syntax would be much more readable. This is the first hypothetical example. The previous two ones are implemented and downloadable from the repository. But here, you can write the grammar rules, and you can add the actions as well. And in this case, someone who's familiar with EBNF or PEG can read that, while that is much harder to read for him. So the so-called domain experts.
It's the only kind who would use Spirit.
Okay, another example, a hypothetical SQL library. Here is a query with an open parameter. We provide it again as a compile time string and generate a function or functor out of it, which takes one parameter, that is the open one. And what it does is, when we call it with foo or whatever, then it generates the safe SQL string, so no SQL injection and these sorts of things, connects to the database and gets back the result. This is also possible. And these functions can be automatically generated out of those things. Error handling. So we're doing all these hacking at compile, yes?
Are you actually running this code? I mean, is this compilable?
You can download it and try it out.
Oh,
it's
okay.
Over there. It's all documented, preference, everything. Right. So, error handling. We're doing all this template hacking. So what happens if I make a mistake there? What type of an error will I get from the compiler? But that's not a nice one. But there is a little bit inconvenient technique which can give you this one-line error message at the end. This line 1 and column 4 means line 1 of the embedded string. So it points you straight to the location of the error. I'm not going to go into detail on the implementation of this one. You can find it in the documentation, and I think I wrote it in the paper as well. Okay, so what's the trick behind these things? We've got a C++ source code and some sort of an embedded string in it, such as the Haskell example. And we give it to the C++ compiler, so it gets our string as well. And we compile it at compile time into a template metaprogram. And still, yeah, this is what it looks like, what we build at compile time. And after that, we execute this template metaprogram and get the result. And here is a huge difference between metaparse and, for example, Spirit, because the parsers we build with Spirit do do this compilation step at runtime and not at compile time. And comparing metaparse to proto, with metaparse you can use a freeform string. It's the input is a string literal, while with proto the input is a C++ expression. And once the compilation is done, the result of the template metaprogram becomes part of the object code. Or it generates an error if that's the goal or whatever. And this is what I'm going to talk about for the rest of this talk. So this compilation step. There are two options I'm aware of for doing this. One of them is based on these constexts functions C++ 11 provides us. The other one is based on template metaprograms. And for the first one, the advantage of that is that the syntax of it is familiar for a C++ compiler. These constexts functions basically C++ functions. But a problem with that is we can only build volumes with that. So for example, a metaprogram cannot be built using a const expression parser. But there is a library that provides utilities to build such parsers. This is called Sprout, and you can find it here.
Question.
Yeah?
Okay, you can only build values, but your value could be a function object, right?
Yes.
So you could build a computation.
Yes, you could build a computation, that's correct, but you cannot build a template meta program, for example. Template meta function is a type. So if you try to do the...
So the great downfall of constexpr is that you cannot generate types that depend on the values of the arguments that you pass to these functions, because they have to be callable as regular, you know, runtime functions. And so that makes them useless for building template metaprograms. Except for that, I might have a trick, but I'm not sure that it pays off.
Are there other questions?
Okay. So what is Sprout then?
Sprout, it's a library for building constexpr-based parsers.
Constexpr-based runtime parsers?
No, compile time parsers. Parsing strings at compile time using constexpr functions.
Okay, and out of it comes
a runtime version. You can call it at runtime because you can call constexpr at runtime. Uh-huh. And you get constexpr volumes out of it.
You get what?
Constexpr volumes. So constant values. The other approach is based on template metaprograms. And the advantage is that we can build types using template metaprograms. But the syntax is more complex, but for template metaprogrammers, it is, of course, familiar. So, okay, this is the approach metaparse uses, so template metaprograms. And the first question when someone tries to build a parser using template metaprograms is, the input is a string literal. How can I pass it to a template metaprogram? And one option is the option Boost.MPL provides. It provides a string template with which we can build strings that can be processed by template metaprograms. But we have to split the strings into four character literals. So it would be really inconvenient to write our Haskell script this way, for example. But what metaparse provides is this syntax. So we can write MPL string hello world, and from this thing will be generated, will be automatically generated at compile time. And I call the MPL strings to follow the boost naming convention that I prefix the macronym with the library name. But I typically use it, and I will use it in the upcoming examples, in a way that I call it underscore s, just to keep it simple, because it comes so often.
Are you
going to
talk about how
this macro works? Yeah, I'm showing how this works. I'm doing everything for you today. So this is our string literal. This is the string we want to get out of it. And the way we do it is we start with an empty string, and we append the first character to it, h. And then we append the second character, and so on and so forth, and we append all the characters to it. And the result of this thing will be, of course, that string that we need. So that's the basic idea. And in C++ 11, instead of providing the characters themselves, we can access the characters of the string literal using the indexing operator. And this
can
is a const expression.
That actually works in C++ 11?
This is a const expression in C++ 11.
Oh, wow.
So that works, yes.
Yeah, so this is horrible. You know, we should have a language feature for this. But it's awesome that they figured this out, right?
Yeah. So yeah, that's the trick, that these things are constant expressions. And the other nice thing is that from this, we can generate this with the preprocessor metaprogramming library. Yes?
So you're not using the four character...
No.
You're using single characters.
Exactly.
Okay.
There's a limit of 64 characters on MPL Street.
I know. Yeah. I found it. So the way we can generate it is that we create this macro, and of course the macro argument is the string literal, and we define a pre-macro and we generate the first part of it, and we build a post-macro and we generate the second part. So we're just using Boost preprocessor metaprogramming. Can you tell me what the major problem with this is? Yes?
String length.
Sorry?
String length.
Exactly.
Yeah, getting to the end. Yeah.
So what happens if I try to write that? Trouble. This thing will be expanded, and in these cases we are over-indexing the string literal at compile time actually. So that's funny. But what we can do with it is we can write a constex function which takes the string and the indexes arguments, and the length of the string is a template argument. And then we can say if we would be over-indexing the string, we just return the null character. Yeah. So that way we fix this. And we can just use that. Can you tell me what's the problem now?
Limit to the length. Yeah.
There's another one.
You're still creating too long a string?
What was that string?
So you're still creating too long a string?
Yeah. So from this, the same will be generated as this one. It just appends a lot of null characters to the end. Or at the end. If we use it as a C star, then it's of course good, but this is not what we want. And what we can do about it is we can implement a conditional pushback, which takes an extra argument whether it should really push it back or not. And what we can say that is if we're over the string, it should just not push it back and should just leave it as is. And that way, this thing will generate the right string out of this thing. Yes?
Question. Couldn't you use const expert and the n that you get out of the length of the string, and based on that n, pre-generate the correct string type and do something like that? Do you get from a string literal to...
You cannot convert a const expert value into a type.
You wouldn't have to, because the only thing, the only... If you just need the string length to fix the MPL string in the first place,
right.
And you can get that one out at compile time through template specialization. Mm-hmm. It would deduce the length of the string from the array parameter.
Right.
But you generate this thing with a macro.
I'm wondering whether you need to.
I'm not aware of any case that you can avoid it.
Why can't we just recursively build the MPL string by pushing back in the template that instantiates itself until we get down to zero?
You cannot give the string to the template.
No.
Yeah.
Other questions? Okay, but moving forward. Well, there is still a limitation, so we generated a 12 iterations, so there's a limit on the length. Well, what we can do about it is that we can make it a macro. How long we want to generate.
So wait, why can't it be more than 11 characters?
Because we generated this out of a macro and it had only, well, it's 12 characters actually. So
yeah, but
it
might be other than that.
Pushback automatically repacks things so that you can get up to 64.
Yeah, if you generate 64 elements here,
yes.
Then you get it.
Yeah.
So the trick here, what I'm doing here is that I define a macro and it says 11, so I generate 11 steps.
Okay.
Out of the MPL strings macro.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Is there a reason you chose 11?
That was the length of hello world. And it just came from the earlier slides. In the library, it's not 11, so there's a different default value. But you can override it the same way you can override things in the generated coding boost. Are there other questions? Then we move forward and I'll talk about the parsers, yes?
I think I'll want you to answer this at the end, or you'll want to answer this at the end, but I'm really curious to know what language features you think we need based on the horrible things you had to do to get this to work.
Strings and compile-time somehow, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, have you thought about it in detail?
Not that much detail. If we could pass the strings to the string literals to the templates as arguments, then we would be fine.
Yeah.
That's for sure, but I haven't thought about it in detail.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be easy.
Okay. So, how can we do parsers? We've got strings, finally. We've got the input. Let's do something with it. The parsers or metaparse is based on parser combinators. So a parser is a function. And since we are in template metaprogramming, a parser is a template meta function. And because we have to pass it to other functions, we should implement it as a template meta function class. And the parsers work in a way that they get a postfix of the entire input, and they start parsing at the beginning of the postfix. And it takes two arguments. The first argument is the postfix itself, and the second one is a compile time or metaprogramming structure that describes the line and column position of the first character of that postfix. We use that for the advanced error reporting.
I'm sorry, I don't understand what you mean by postfix in this case.
So you have a string hello world, and you've already parsed hello, and you start from world now.
Okay.
And you give it to a parser.
So
okay.
You mean suffix?
Suffix, yeah.
Sure. Okay. So you're just saying you're parsing the rest of the input.
Exactly. Yes. And post tells me where it is at the input.
Okay.
Position.
Yeah. The two things a parser should return is it should either say error, it's broken, or it can say, okay, I've successfully parsed it. Here is the result. Result is an arbitrary template metaprogramming value. It can give you the remaining string, so the unconsumed end of the string, and the beginning source position of that. So these are the two possible outcomes. Let's look at a very simple parser then. It is called return.
When you say error, does it mean compile-time error?
No, it is a metaprogramming data structure describing a parsing error.
Right.
Yes. So, one of the simplest parsers is something called return, and it is called return for a reason, we know. What it does is it accepts every input, it doesn't consume any character, and it just returns this result as a result of parsing. This is the implementation. It's not that important. Here is another such...
you have multi-valued meta functions.
Yeah, Metaparse provides meta functions for accessing these things. So you shouldn't access these things individually.
Okay.
Of course, it is properly written.
Okay.
I feel better now. So there is another one, fail, which rejects every input, and it fails with this error message. And here is the implementation, and the same holds for this as well. And here is a third simple parser. It consumes the first character of the input. And the result of parsing of this character, and of course, it gives the remaining of the string back as the result. I don't show you how we calculate the upcoming source position. It's not trivial, but not that difficult as well. It has to deal with the line endings and these sorts of things. Yes?
So if it was zero length, you'd throw an error or something? Or?
Yes, exactly. And what's also not included is that for an empty string or an empty input, it gives you an error. Exactly. Good point. The real implementation does it, of course. So here is an example. I've got the word if or keyword if, and I want to parse it. So I can parse the letter I with a one car, and I can parse the letter F with another one car parser using the remaining.
So you are consuming the character with
yes,
your parser.
Yes, exactly. One car consumer.
Do you have some look ahead?
Metaparse has a look ahead, I don't talk about it right now.
Ah.
But you can find it more parsed. But the thing is that one car accepts any character. So if I wrote there XX, then it would accept it, which is not good. It would be nice if we could have a version of one car that accepts only the letter I. And this is where the parser combinators come into the picture. They build more complex parsers out of simple ones. So we can take the one car parser and build another parser out of it that accepts only the letter I, not everything. We can do it with this parser combinator, which is called SF1. It has three arguments, the parser to build on, the predicate to check the result of parsing with, and an error message to fail with when the predicate returns false. And here is the implementation, which is not that simple. It has to check if the first parser failed or not. If it failed, it has to propagate the error, otherwise it can check the...
Slow down, please.
I don't think the implementation details are very important here.
I just wanted to read it through, but okay.
Well, we can wait, but...
Alright,
okay, then we build another one, lit. We can give it a literal, and it will accept only that literal, so that specific character. And we can implement it with accept one. So we can say that, okay, we transform one car, and our predicate will be, is the result equal to the character we need or not. And of course, if not, then we can generate some nice and human readable error message with string concatenation and these sorts of things. At compile time, of course. So this was the quick introduction to this Metaparse library. I will not show you all the combinators and all the parsers. You can look it up in the reference and the documentation. I will show you how to build this Haskell thingy with this. So, yes, the idea behind it is that Haskell and tablet metaprogramming have the same logic as Bartosz yesterday talked about it. So, this is the Haskell string we start with. And the idea is that we build an abstract syntax tree out of it, and then we generate the template meta function class out of that abstract syntax tree. And we start building the grammar little by little. So we start with this simple expression. We either accept an integer token, which is just an integer literal, or a name token, which is the name of a function, such as fib. And int token is something we get from metaparse. This one we have to implement, but it's easy to implement, so I will not go into details on that. And we have to build the abstract syntax tree, of course. So we create templates for building the EST. One for the volumes and one for the names, which we call references because they refer to some meta function or something. And this is how we can build the parsers for them. So there is a parser combinator in metaparse called transform, which takes a parser, applies it, it gives us some result, and then it transforms that result with some lambda function. And here we just build the AST out of these.
So this is just fine.
No, it's not monadic at all right now. It's just a parser combinator.
But it calls a lambda, takes a parser, executes it, and calls the lambda.
Mine will come later, so be patient.
Okay.
We can build this parser in a similar way. This is just a function, transform, that takes a parser, and a lambda function to transform the result with. So it gives us back a string, and we build an AST reference out of it. Yes?
I have a little bit of an unrelated question. So, because I've been mentioning monads, and you know, there's a reason which you are implementing and using monads here. And I know that there's an extension to the idea of monads called arrows, and I'm wondering, is there any reason why arrows are not being given special treatment in this case?
I'm not familiar with them, so I cannot answer the question.
Arrows aren't exactly an extension of monads. Arrows are actually
parsers don't have to be built with monads in Haskell. They are usually built with applicatives, which are less than monads.
Yeah. So is there any reason why it's not a applicative functor that is being used? It's not.
It's probably a choice in this case.
I'm not familiar with that one, and I'm familiar with monads, so it isn't really a choice, to be perfectly honest.
So I'm just trying to understand the what slide means. That 13, you're going to represent that with the AST value of MDL in 13?
Yes, in the abstract syntax tree.
Okay, and so that's going to be the AST element associated with that?
Yes.
That parse node, and then if you parse a name token, then you're going to get an AST ref of an MDL. Gotcha. And these two transforms they're essentially the parsers. Right. So the parsers are also doing the semantic.
Yeah. They will give us the AST back.
Yeah. Okay.
Immediately.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Yeah. So when we have these parsers, we can build the single expression parser out of it by using one of, which is an order choice.
Oh, here's a quick question. It seems like stylistically you could simplify that MDL code a lot by just passing the AST ref of the placeholder instead of wrapping it all in lambda, since you could always do the lambda-ish thing on the inside.
Well, if it was a metafunction class, I could do that. It transform accept or expects a metafunction class. And ESTref was just a template.
I see. You could have made transform accept any arbitrary lambda, right? But you said nothing.
It expects a metafunction class.
Okay, so the stylistic recommendation in the book, say, is have your, instead of just accepting metafunction classes, accept ordinary, any old lambda, and then you can use MPL apply to apply.
You mean leaving the lambda parts out?
Yeah.
Well, when I constructed more complicated parsers with this, then the lambda library got confused where the boundaries of the lambda expressions are.
I gotcha.
So I changed it in a way that I write it all the time.
Okay.
So that's the reason.
Okay.
Then let's make our language more complicated. Let's parse function applications. In Haskell, we don't have parentheses, we just write the function name and the arguments after that. So here's an example, we call fib with 6 as an argument. This is the grammar for that. And of course, we have an AST representation of it. It has two arguments, the function itself and the argument. And both of them are expressions, so the function can come out of an expression as a result. And here is an example for that. So we've got the AST, and we need to generate some sort of a metafunction out of it. And we generate a nullary metafunction out of these expressions. And when we evaluate that nullary metafunction, that is the point when the expression gets evaluated. So for example, when we try to divide by 0, then this is the point where we get the compilation error, when we evaluate it, and not during the compilation. And we introduce a metafunction bind, which has nothing to do with monads. It takes the AST and gives the metafunction class back. And these are the three AST node types we have so far. And out of the volume, using this simple template, we can create a nullary metafunction. And of course, int itself is a nullary metafunction, but when we try to use it with int or double or something that's not prepared for it, then this thing helps. When we have an application, then we have to do it lazily. So we first have to evaluate the first argument, because that's just another metafunction, and then we can do the application. And for references, that's an open question. What do we do with references? And the idea there is that, well, let's use a lookup table, which tells me, okay, if it's fib, then this is the value which should be bound to that. And Boost.MPL provides a map data structure which we can use here. But this environment has to be an argument of kind, of course.
So this is your symbol table?
Yes, basically that's a symbol table. So here is an example. We've got this expression, plus 6, 7. And we do the parsing and we get this AST. As you can see that when a function has more arguments, then we use nested applications. So one application applies only one parameter. Yes, this is basically doing currying. Mm-hmm. And when we use bind, then we get something like this. Lazy applications, nested of course, and we do the binding of this class to the boost MPL class, for example.
So bind transformed your AST into a metafunction?
Yes. Exactly.
Right.
But the problem is that it tries to use plus in a... So it assumes that plus is curried, but the plus implementation of MPL is not curried. So we have to implement it ourselves. But that's the first approach, of course. We have to make it lazy, and we have to make it curried. But after that, it just works. And this is what happens when we try to evaluate it. So here is the meta function we generated. And when we try to evaluate it, then it will evaluate this argument first. And it calls MPL apply, and it applies the value 6 on this curried lazy plus. Yes?
I'm curious why you do this in two stages. I mean, couldn't you just build the meta function and skip the AST construction?
But later on, we will need the AST.
Okay.
So later on, if you don't get the answer, then ask it again. So yeah, and this thing just calls the nested apply. And after that, once we have evaluated this thing, then the outer application does the same thing. It applies 7 on the result of this.
So nothing.
Okay.
So I'm just shaking my head to all the things.
Okay. Good. So that's how it works, and what we have so far is a parsing and a binding. And we assume that these environments magically exist. And now we are going to look at how we can build these things. And we create a helper template class for this. It has a template argument, m, and this is the math we have so far. And we can say that builder with the empty map, we can call that meta HS, where HS stands for the Haskell style language, of course. And we can have a nested template class called import, which takes a name and some volume to bind to that name. And what it does, it inherits from builder itself and inserts this thing into the map. And this is good because after that we can write these things. So we can just list all the things we want to import into this map. And we can just write, okay, I want plus to be the curried plus, I want minus to be the curried lazy minus. And since we are inheriting from builder itself, we can just do it infinitely. And we could do the currying automatically. So we can make the compiler do the currying for us. And we don't have to implement it ourselves. I'm not going to tell you the details of it, but we can define these meta functions which just do that. And after that, we can say, okay, I can have an import 1, an import 2, an import 3, and so on. And after that, I can write it this way. So import 2 plus lazy plus.
What is the 1 and 2? What are the numbers?
Arguments.
Number of arguments. Oh, I see,
yeah.
That's the error.
The number of arguments of this function.
The error.
So we have different
template
arguments.
Right.
Okay, and for laziness, we could do the same, but we would be having issues with eval if in MPL, for example. So that's why there is no make lazy function so far. So this is what we can do now. And this is what we should be able to do next. So we should be able to use our Haskell language to define things. So we can import things now, and we should be able to define them. And for that we need to extend the grammar, of course. So we need to say, okay, there will be a name token, x, equals, and some expression. And what we get out of this thing is the name of the thing we're defining, and an abstract syntax tree, which is the value of this thing. And there is a trick here. the definition of x uses y, which is defined later, of course. So if we try to do the binding of this AST here, then we would get an error because there is no y yet. And this is the reason why we store the ASTs in the map instead of executing these things immediately. And this is where we need the ASTs.
Okay, so what I think I see in the top blue box now is you are both defining your symbol table and then telling it to actually do some parsing, right?
Yes, basically, yes.
So define is actually parse this.
Parse this and put it into the...
Oh, and put it into the symbol table. I said this is part of the symbol table construction.
Yes, so the point here is that a symbol x will be defined. This will be
okay. I got it.
Yes. So, in order that this works, then define has to only partially pass this, right?
No, it parses it completely. And keeps the AST.
It builds the complete AST.
Yes.
Okay. And then it looks up the name
no,
of the definition.
It doesn't. It just stores the AST.
It just stores the AST.
Yes. And when we use it, then it will do the cut. And by then we define it.
But how does it, where does it store the AST? Doesn't it bind to X?
It binds the AST to X. So in this mapping,
it at least has to look at the AST to find out the name token from the definition production.
By parsing this thing, we get back a pair.
Yeah.
A name and the AST. And this is the name which will be
so
the
we
name.
So we get the name on the left side and the AST of the application on the right side.
Yes. Yes, but we've changed the rules of this symbol table we have, because previously we assumed that there are values in it, but now there are ASTs in it. So we have to change everything according to that, and we've been importing things, and these things have to become ASTs as well in order to make this thing work. And because of that, we need to introduce a new AST element, AST bound, which represents a value which we just wrote in, and we had to put it into the AST. And here was our import, which just inserted the name and the value pair into the map, and now we have to insert an AST bound value into the map. So now we are inserting an AST. And when we're doing the binding, it became tricky as well, because previously when we were doing the binding, we could just look the value up and put it there and that's it. But now we get an AST, so we need to bind that as well, recursively basically. So this is what we've been doing so far. When we found this in the AST, we just looked it up and that's it, we're done. But now we have to look it up and do the binding as well. Then it works. Okay, so now we can define values. Let's define functions, such as the Fibonacci. We want to get working, of course. And for that, we need to introduce some abstractions. So we need a new AST element, AST lambda, which has a body and an argument name. And the argument name is a string, the body is an AST. And this is the definition of it. And yeah, we just generate the whole thing out of this. It's not complicated. For example, here is a function definition. We define a function f with two arguments, a and b. And that is the body. And this is the AST we generate out of it. So when the function has more arguments, then we generate nested lambdas here as well. One lambda for a, one lambda for b. And inside that, there is the body, or the definition of this whole thing. But doing the binding of a lambda abstraction is tricky again, because the lambda abstraction has an argument. And we don't know the value of this argument until the lambda abstraction is actually called. So we know the value of this argument when we call that function we generate with this lambda abstraction. So what the current implementation on GitHub does is that it builds a meta function out of a lambda, which just stores the symbol table. And when it is called, then it knows the value of the extra argument, it puts it into the symbol table, and then it does the binding. And after that, it evaluates things in the
Haskell. So you are sort of implementing a Haskell runtime at this point.
We have to, right. Because we're running Haskell at compile time.
Right.
Exactly.
The runtime.
Exactly. So yeah, in this example, we import a function and we define another one. These are the two elements in our symbol table. And we bind this syntax tree to plus and this nested syntax tree to F. So that is what we're doing. And of course, we can say that, okay, we can extend the parser, so when it sees an A plus B, then it compiles it as it wasn't plus AB. So when we write that in our Haskellish language A plus B, then it will be compiled as plus AB and it will call the function plus. And we can extend our simple meta HS in a way that it defines plus and minus or imports the boost NPL functions by default. So whenever someone tries to use this thing, he can already use plus, minus, times, and so on. And if or eval if from boost can be imported as well. So we can we have to change it a little bit because it assumes that the condition is not lazy. So we have to build a version where the condition is lazy as well. But that thing we can import. And after that we can write this thing down. And since we're doing everything lazily, it just works. So we can write a factorial function using this, for example. And it just works. Yes?
Why did you suffix it with an underscore?
Because, well, here I did suffix it because of the next slide, which you will see. Are there other questions? Okay. So in Haskell, there is a syntax for if then else, and we can prepare the parser for this and compile this into that. So that's why there is the underscore. And then we've got everything we need for the Fibonacci, actually. And there's a nice thing about this solution is that we can define libraries. So we can say that, okay, I take meta hs, I define this factorial function, and I call it fact library. And then I can use this fact library. And then I can use it again, and again, and again. So using this, we can build template metaprogramming libraries, basically. Okay, we can define a map. We should be able to get the meta functions out of this thing. So we can introduce a get element into this DSL, basically, where we say, okay, I want fact. And what this thing gives us back is a meta function, which is the factorial meta function. And then we can use it just as any other meta function. So we can call it, or we can give it to a transform in BoostMPL. We can do whatever we want with it. So we've got this meta Haskellish language. And when we have regular meta functions, we can just simply import them. We can define our own meta functions, and we can get meta functions out. So we can communicate in both directions with the regular complete meta programming. Yes?
Does this system work just as well with meta functions operating on types as well as numbers?
Yes. Okay. But it was easier to see. Okay. So it's extremely expressive, we've seen that. How fast is this thing? That is what we asked. So what we did was created a Fibonacci, we generated a Fibonacci out of it, and we implemented one manually as well. And we implemented it with BoostMPL, just to make it a fair comparison, because what we generate is based on BoostMPL as well. And this is the box we tested on and compared and everything. Well, the numbers are not that nice, actually. The red one is obviously the generated one. We measure the memory usage, and we measure the compilation time as well. Yes?
The one that you did using the NPL, did you do it with lazy stuff?
No.
Okay, so this may be a huge impact on your thing, because the first person to do lazy NPL was Vasek Hartman. I don't know if you know about his work well. I mean, so he posted some stuff to the Boost list. And just for everybody else here, what it means to do lazy NPL is essentially you make everything into a meta function. So So you don't evaluate anything until you finally reach in and get the nested type out, and then the evaluation happens. Okay, so everything is a meta function. Any types you want to manipulate, you wrap them up in something. I tried to apply this technique to the sieve of Aristosthenes just for fun to see what happened, and it was really inefficient. And we're not sure exactly what it is inside the compiler that makes this happen, but you actually have to sort of force non-laziness at some points in order to get it to not explode like that.
That could be the reason. Then.
So yeah, it may not have to do with your parsing and language at all.
Okay. Does that help me? Did that have to do with the compiler? Did you try that more than one compiler?
I don't remember, but their models are similar enough that this is you know not likely to be different.
Do you think you could track down what happens and find out that the compiler could somehow optimize it?
Well, you could. You know how to debug client, right?
I do, but I probably would need help with debugging with understanding the test case.
Oh yeah, sure. Well, I'll work with you on that if you want.
You could. Yeah. It would be interesting.
Well, it's not the only thing we tested. So we said, okay, we've got this Haskell interpreter at compile time. This explodes, but are the parsers efficient or are they not? Because out of this, we cannot see this. So we measured the parsers themselves as well. And we chose expressive, and the example I showed before with expressive, that simple language on top of it. And that thing generates the same thing we would write by hand. So it's easy to compare things. We can write it by hand and measure it, or we can generate it and then measure it. And we try to measure the different steps of the generation to see the big picture. For technical reasons, we had to measure it on a different box with these parameters, and we could only measure the speed. But here are the results. So first of all, there's the blue line, which shows that we didn't do anything but included every header file.
Wow.
This was the speed. After that, we tested our string creation trick. I told you.
Sorry, question. Yeah. Did you try any PCH precompiled header?
No. It was without them. So we did this string creation, this hacking with the nested pushbacks and everything I showed before. And it surprisingly had a little overhead when any. So here were obviously measurement mistakes, but yeah, it didn't have any real overhead on top of that. And the other one is the handcrafted version, and the green one is the generated one. So it didn't have that much of an overhead.
What do handcrafted and generated mean here?
Handcrafted is the expressive expression created by hand with the operators.
Okay.
And generated is the same thing automatically generated from a compile-time string.
Okay.
Basically, the same random expression used most cases, and it's just repeating the same in two more lines.
Yeah, we measured it longer and longer random expressions. So that is the.
And you actually generate the NFA that matches the regular expression.
He makes expressive to it. He's just building the expressive string.
We created an expressive regular expression object. We generated that out of the string.
Okay, I got you.
So the whole point was building an interface on top of expressive.
I see, yes.
And the point of this measurement was to see if it is a real use case of this library. It looks like it is, that we can build nice interfaces. That was the first one.
Does it matter at all what kind of expression? I mean, you said it's just a repeated thing. Does it matter if it had, you know, any stars in it or whatever?
Well, it shouldn't matter because it's still different templates. So the compiler had to instantiate different templates anyway.
Okay. So that means like recursion doesn't.
No, it shouldn't.
Okay. Like the depth of the recursion on the parser doesn't matter. Okay.
Let's see, you go up to length 12. Did you try going to a lot longer lengths to see if that?
12 is the number of times we use that pattern. So it's not the number of characters, and then we hit the MPL strings.
Oh, okay.
Are there other questions about this? Okay, well, we're sort of out of time. What I have left is how we can do parsers with advanced techniques using monads. I think I'll talk about it anyway, and if someone wants to leave, we can leave. Okay. So let's get back to our SFM parser. This is how we implemented it. And the trick here was that we had three arguments, the parser we built the new parser out of, the predicate, and the potential error message. And we applied the parser, we checked if it succeeded. If it failed, then we propagated the error. Otherwise, we proceeded with the SFM specific details. Here is another parser combinator I haven't shown yet. This is always. It takes a parser, it parses the input with it, and if it accepts the input, then it throws the result away and gives this constant value back as the result. So it just changes the result of another parser. And the way we implement it is that we apply this parser, we check if it succeeded. If it failed, then we propagate the error, otherwise we do our thing. So this seems to be a recurring pattern here. And here's another thing out of the Haskell language, where we have this definition of a value. We have a name, an equal thing, and an application. And the way we could implement a parser for it is using this sequence combinator, which takes a number of parsers, parses the input using them one after another, and at the end it gives us back a sequence of the results. And what we have to do with that afterwards is get the result of this out of the sequence, and get the result of this out of the sequence, and build a pair of it, and that is the result we want to give back. So we have to transform it, and it's not that trivial to follow what's going on. And there is error propagation on top of it, of course, so it makes it really complicated to implement this thing. And it would be really nice if we could do this instead. Okay, we want to parse the input with a name token, and we want to call the result name. We want to parse the input with the define token, and we want to call the result ignore, which is a self-documenting variable name. And we want to parse the input with application, and we want to store the result as body, and this is what we want to give back. So it's much more readable than the previous version. And this is how we can do it. We can make these things arguments of lambda abstractions. It's not the boost and the lambda expression. It's a lambda expression metamonad provides. We can specify what the name of the argument is. And after that we can say, okay, the argument of this lambda expression is name, the argument of this one is ignore, and so on. And we have these bind functions. And the bind function takes a parser, such as name token, define token, application, and the lambda expression. And what it does is that it parses the input with the parser, and when it succeeds, it gives the result to this lambda expression and expects the lambda expression to give us a parser back, which we can go further with. And if we build binds into each other, or we put binds into each other, we can get this thing out of it. So this is how it works. Here is bind. It takes a parser as an argument. It takes a lambda expression as an argument, and then it gives us a parser back. And when we try to parse something with it, well, we pass the input to this huge parser we get from bind. And what bind does is that it parses the input using the original parser, name token in this example. If it fails, then this huge parser just gives the error back and that's it. If it succeeds, it gives the result to the lambda. The lambda gives us a new parser, and we can provide the remaining input to this new parser and keep parsing with it. And because we've got these lambdas inside each other, this parser will be similar to this one. And it's a recursive structure we have here. Yes?
Of course, this is just a monad, and you know, you could write something like a do meta function that generates all of this.
It will come.
Oh, wow.
So we've got 2+1 operations. We've got a parser which takes, or we've got a function, a function that takes a string, gives us a parser that stops this bind sequence in a way that it fails. We've got another meta function that takes some arbitrary value, which is a result, and gives us a parser that stops this bind sequence in a way that it succeeds. And we've got this bind, of course, which takes the parser and the lambda, and it builds this huge parser for us. And this is a parser monad in Haskell. I'm not talking about monads in general, only about this.
So it's really a state monad with together with either monad.
Yes, it does the error handling as well. Yeah, you could build out of the state monad and the either monad as well. So you could build it out of that. But the nice thing is that in Haskell there is a two notation. So we had these binds, and there were lots of binds overall, and it wasn't that nice. It was nicer than the one before, but it was still that nice. But Haskell has this two notation, which makes it easier to read. And in MetaMonad, I've implemented it for template metaprogramming. So we can just borrow that in MetaParse as well. We have to say do parser, which is the do template set. And after that, I can say, OK, I want to parse the input with name token. I want to call it name. I want to parse the input with define token, and I don't care about the result. And I want to parse the input with application, I want to call it body. And this is what I want to give back at the end. And for those who are familiar with the Haskell syntax, this is how it looks like in Haskell. Yes?
Name and body, would they just be empty tag structs, or?
Yes, anything that's the, so it's name and body comes from the lambda part of the MetaMonad library, and they are types that are declared, at least declared.
You just care about the name of the type.
Yes, exactly. So you could use any meta function there if you wanted to, but then that would be your name. So you can just declare a struct and you can use its name. So as a summary, I've showed a few examples where parsing at compile time is useful. I show you how to parse with metaprograms, and I presented the Metaparse library, which gives this all to you. So you can just go there, download it, and start using it and build these things. And most of the things I've showed you are there as examples. And I've showed a real world example, which is there as well. This is the Haskellish DSL. So thank you for the attention. Are there further questions? Yes?
I had a crazy idea.
That's a first.
Why not just build Haskell into compile time C++? So that this thing would just work without you having to...
Just C++ and compile time C++ in order to learn another language.
Yeah. I mean, this way you can sort of simulate that.
You are simulating something that could have been built into and make the rest of the compile time in C++ deprecated.
New feature into the standard or what?
Because this is such a universal thing. I mean, you have a language of compile time and you can do anything with it. You can write an arbitrary complex meta function using Haskell syntax. And what else do you need?
You need to be able to reuse all of the libraries that you already have that run in C++ at runtime. You want to be able to use those at compile time.
Well, I'm saying deprecated, not
My point is, if you make the native language Haskell, then you have this issue that people have a whole bunch of code that they now can't take advantage of in this new world. And they have to learn this new language.
No, I mean, the transitional period, you would have both.
Yeah, you mean like the next 400 years.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm thinking about the future.
The future.
So the thing is, you could come at that from the other side. You could say, I have Haskell, and I write my Haskell library that emits C++ code. Uh-huh. And I think we have 3 years ago, someone actually did that. Mm-hmm. So he basically built this, he built a Haskell library, and you could basically, depending on how you called it, it was using type classes, and you could call it in two modes. You could either just run the program and look at the output, interactive and interpreter, or you call it a different way and it generated MPL meta code from the Haskell code. So I mean, that's one way to go about it. It's not embedded in the C++ compiler anymore.
I'd rather have it embedded.
Yes, you would.
Yes?
Do you want to do
something? Are there Boost.Spirit GSM in Metaparse?
Not yet.
Oh.
But the expressive parser is just a proof concept. So it's not a full regular expression language. It's more of a proof of that it's possible.
Sprout library is Spirit syntax support.
It's not implemented. Not implemented yet.
Why would you want to support Spirit syntax and not just PEG? Spirit syntax is nasty. Right? They would choose PEG if they could.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They can. Yes.
So when I look at how you're defining the symbol tables, what I see there is a mixture of your meta parsing strings and expression templates, and it's quite natural. You know, you've got this nice boundary. You know, every time you do a new declaration, you have a new expression template, and then inside of that, you're passing some strings. So have you thought much about what the best way to combine expression templates and this kind of thing might be? And I think it could be important, especially because you have a fixed length on it.
Yes. I haven't thought about this, so I just built these interfaces.
Well, the fixed length limit comes from MPL string, which is not implemented using variadic templates, right?
So no, it also comes from the nature of the language and what you have to do to get the characters out of the string constants they compile on. It's, remember his macro that you have?
Yeah.
He can only generate that to a fixed length.
Right. Yeah.
So
I think that would not be too hard to implement as an experimental extension in a compiler.
Oh, sure.
So it actually took me a week to get a very rudimentary string template argument to work in this way.
Yeah.
It's not anywhere near usable for anything except that particular one case where I wanted to use it.
Yeah, and it's, you know, that's for the next standard. I'm talking about, you know, now we have C++ 11, and let's think about how we should do metaprogramming in this day and age. And so, you know, this is obviously a great tool, but it's going to have some limitations, and so how do you combine it with the other tools? That's the question.
That's an interesting question to play with.
I don't know yet.
I mean, the obvious difference between this and expression templates is that expression templates is also runtime.
Well, sort of. I mean, so I was looking at this Haskell mini program, and I was thinking, well, we could build an expression template based thing that would generate the same MPL metaprogram.
Yeah. Emulates Haskell syntax.
Huh?
It would emulate Haskell syntax as best it could.
Yeah,
it wouldn't look anything like Haskell.
No, but whatever. I mean, maybe it would look a little bit like Haskell. But the point is that it would that the value you get out of your expression template could be an instance of a meta function.
Okay.
And then use decal type, or if you need to get this type out for whatever reason. You know, there are ways to get back from runtime to compile time. You
yes.
get the type out now. So. So we could do all those same things with expression templates, and the question is, where are the cases that you have a compelling advantage doing it this way? Or maybe I'm asking the question wrong because I haven't used this, but maybe this is so much easier to use than say Proto or something that the question now has to be where are the compelling cases where you have to use expression templates.
But I would say, why use expression templates at all?
Because there's a length limitation, if nothing else.
Okay.
This is great as long as your Haskell program is no more than 64 characters.
But one definition of your Haskell program, because every function defined individually in different strings.
Right.
But so you can't share like variable name, like a function declared in one Haskell program.
Sure.
You can. Build these maps, and you could just combine.
Oh, okay, then you run as the limit of map length.
The limit of map length is the limit for one function definition.
No, MPL map. Only call something else.
Yeah.
So that's not true.
Since when?
Huh?
Since when?
Since forever. It depended on your compiler implementation, whether it had a type of emulation, and now since all compilers have a type of emulation, because they have decal type, now it's only. So it was MPL map for things with type of. It was built with a recursive data structure, essentially that we use overloading to find the element.
So this Fibonacci definition in Haskell wasn't one string, it was one string per line in a variadic macro instantiation.
No, it was,
it was one string.
It was just identation. So that was one string literal because they got concatenated.
You could make it one string per line. You could divide them in arbitrary places, right? So the length limit really doesn't have to mean anything, right? You could put commas in between these things. And
yeah, but that makes it more difficult to read.
Sure, but you could you let the writer pick a likely place for the comma where it's not gonna. I know Haskell purists don't like anything in between anything, but you know, like in between function declarations or statements where
but in between statement. Function declarations, so function declarations are now separated.
Okay, well, already. Yeah.
So what you can do is there's an alternative syntax in Haskell where you actually use braces and semicolons instead of formatting. So that would be something probably easier to implement, and you could then chop it at semicolon.
I didn't think that Haskell was white face sensitive.
It is.
I mean, it doesn't have to be because you have the alternative syntax,
right.
But nobody uses the alternative syntax because they like formatting.
Right.
It makes it clear.
Is it sensitive to indentation or is it just the nuance?
No, it's indentation.
Indentation.
It's
okay.
Basically a rule of how to translate indentation to braces.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Further questions? Comments? Yes?
Are there parts of this that would make sense to put into MPL, like the string part? Where would you partition it?
Well, the strings are general, but I just needed them, so I put them here.
Yeah.
And there are a few utility functions here and there.
Of course, that only works C++ alone.
Yes. I define it in a way that it generates an error, otherwise. Yes?
Now, have you thought about adding the type of the function? In Haskell, you can...
No data
constructors yet? Or?
No, it's all I have yet. It's more of a proof of concept.
Okay.
Well, that would be a way of putting concepts into C++.
Right. Yeah, some matches
are
welcome,
I'm sure. Terms
of generic Haskell, too. Simon Payton-Jones was very disappointed to see that in C++ metaprogramming, there's no type checking at compile time. You know, it's a dynamic language at compile time. you want to catch those errors earlier. Which I can't blame him.
How much earlier than compile time can you get? Like even before you hit compile?
Well, the idea is before you generate big stack back phases.
Yeah,
right.
I know.
Okay.
Are there other questions? Then thank you for your attention.